We've done everything we can to take advantage of this slowdown and do things that move the project forward. Even though the project construction has been delayed by federal litigation, we've made a lot of progress this year. We're hopeful that the litigation will be complete in 2021. We'll be able to start construction. We finished our design. We got the design approved by the state engineer's office. At the same time, we hired a contractor. We hired Barnard Construction. And Barnard Construction has been doing work on the project, getting all the paperwork and permits and everything that need to be completed before they actually start construction. We have spent a lot of 2020 working with financial staff from all of our participants from the 12 cities and towns, as well as their attorneys and bond counsel, putting together contracts and financial agreements so that when the federal litigation is done and we start construction, we can have the money that we need to actually build the project. At the same time, we're doing some of the mitigation that we need to do as part of Windy Gap firming.
Well, we're up here at Lake Granby to do some mercury fish tissue sampling. As a commitment related to permitting for the Windy Gap firming project, we go out and do this with Colorado Parks and Wildlife. Parks and Wildlife is out on the lake pulling nets, and they're going to bring us back a sample of fish, and we're going to do our tissue sampling here on shore.
This is our annual gillnet survey of the fish population in Lake Granby, and this is the perfect opportunity to get fish to take mercury samples and take advantage of that through a partnership with Northern Water. It's a real valued partnership. We work well together and are able to share resources in a lot of different ways. Great partner on all kinds of different projects, not just this, lot the wide range of projects.
Since we only take a small portion of the fish's fillet for our samples, most of the rest of the fish is still intact, and CPW makes sure that those fish go to volunteers or other licensed anglers. Well, mercury is a ubiquitous environmental contaminant. It's emitted by power plants and various industrial processes, and there is some inorganic mercury that's geologic.
If we have high concentrations of mercury in fish that people tend to catch a lot of and eat a lot of, we need to know that and we need to keep the public informed.
Our commitment with the Windy Gap firming project is to monitor fish tissue mercury in the three lakes. We'll start with the Granby, we'll move on to Shadow Mountain, we'll also do Grand Lake, and in Carter and Horsetooth Reservoir on the East Slope. We have a commitment to monitor fish tissue mercury at Chimney Hollow as well once it's built.
We're moving forward with the connectivity channel, making a lot of progress. We did just hire a contractor. We have AECOM doing design with Concrete Express Inc. as the contractor to help out during the design. It's kind of an interesting project because we'll drain Windy Gap Reservoir, make it, build a new dam to make the reservoir a little smaller than it was before, and have a new channel around it.
The connectivity channel has a good shot at helping reshape the habitat down here. The hope is that that will produce possibly a stronger fishery down here for CPW and the general public. We're up here today to help Parks and Wildlife install some of the antennas for the fish movement study they're conducting that's related to the connectivity channel project at Windy Gap.
Dean, this is actually the largest fish movement study that we've undertaken, to my knowledge, I think in the entire state, at least for quite some time.
So we're installing antennas into the river that can read the pit tags that we're going to be putting into the fish later this fall. And basically we'll be able to tell which direction those fish are moving when they pass each of these antenna stations. And with the antenna stations spaced multiple miles apart up and down the river, we can tell how far those fish are moving in the system. And so that's all part of the connectivity channel construction, and we'll be able to get a baseline movement of these fish for the next 2 years on the brown trout, rainbow trout, and sculpin, and kind of see what their movement rates are with the dam in. And then once that connectivity channel is constructed and the fish can move around Windy Gap Reservoir, we'll see if those movement rates change and those fish are actually using that connectivity channel over time.
Well, Northern Water is funding this project, and we're fortunate that we can also come out and participate in some of the work and help get it done.
It's a pretty labor-intensive thing to install these things, but once they're installed, they're going to be up and running for 5 years accumulating data, and it's going to be a massive amount of data that tells us a lot about what's going on in the river.
The antennas are made out of some pretty heavy gauge copper wire, and that's what sends the electromagnetic signal that can read the pit tags. And so we've got to lay those on the bottom of the stream so that electromagnetic field can detect those tags as those fish pass over it. And all of that's connected to our system on shore, which has the readers that can store the tag numbers based on the time that the fish passed. And we can get a unique number per fish, and so we know which fish passed at what time of day. And it can just read those fish like a barcode as they go past over the next 5 years.
It's going to generate so much data to show patterns of fish movement before and then also after. So we're going to be able to just directly observe what the changes in fish movements are. And if everything goes according to plan and it does what we expect it to do, we're going to see huge changes in that dynamic of fish movement before and after the project is built.
Today we're doing a couple different things out here in the river. First, we're getting two past population estimates from the Kaibab Park location in the Fraser River, and that'll give us an estimate of the brown trout, rainbow trout, and sculpin density in this section of the river. And then the fish that we're capturing during those population estimates, we're also putting pit tags in for the fish movement study. And these are the tags that will work with our antennas that we put in a couple weeks ago that'll make it so that we can tell if these fish are moving far distances in the river. So we have three types of fish that we're aiming to put tags in today, brown trout, rainbow trout, and mottled sculpin. And we're hoping to tag about 125 of each species. From beginning to end, we do the electrofishing, running the electrodes through the river, and that's what actually shocks the fish for just a short amount of time so that we can capture those fish. We're using a clove oil substitute called AQUATIC, and we're authorized to use that by the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service. It's safe for the fish. It knocks them out fairly quickly. We can put the tag in without the fish moving so that we don't injure the fish when we're inserting the tag into those fish. And then they wake up relatively quickly once they're put into clean water.
One of the things that we're hoping to do this fall is to harvest some plants that we can use after we reestablish the new connectivity channel with the smaller reservoir. We'll need to plant willows and cottonwoods as well as other grasses. So we're going out there this fall to start harvesting plants. We'll send them to CSU Plant Center. They'll grow the plants in their nursery, and we will take them back out when the connectivity channel is constructed. And those plants will help minimize erosion and cause a more natural system for aquatic life out at the connectivity channel long term. Other mitigation things that we're doing at the same time, we are working still with learning by doing. Altogether, there are numerous projects that are going to be related to Colorado River streamflow, closely related to connectivity channel, and the learning by doing group is going to oversee those projects and to make sure they all fit together and work well together when they're all completed. The learning by doing stakeholders are very closely tied with the connectivity channel. Trout Unlimited got a grant for about $8 million from the Natural Resource Conservation Service, and $5.8 million of that grant was for the connectivity channel. Grand County is also very closely involved, coordinating things with property owners and helping us get permits and other things. Colorado Parks and Wildlife is involved in the fish monitoring study. They're also involved heavily in the review of the design to make sure that the design of the connectivity channel meets the Parks and Wildlife's standards for stream restoration. In the end, we'll probably have $20 to $25 million worth of money spent on connectivity channel and stream restoration between Windy Gap and Kremling. The Trout Unlimited grant was for about $8 million for the connectivity channel and some stream restoration down in the Kremling area on some ranches. So there's some money there for stream restoration and modifications. And then there also is additional funding from the Windy Gap Firming Project mitigation. About $7 million of funding coming from the Northern Municipal Subdistrict in Denver Water for additional stream restoration and improvements on the Colorado River between Windy Gap and the Williams Fork River. And then there is additional money that's coming in, another $8 to $10 million from other funders, including the state of Colorado. Colorado Water Conservation Board has given us over $2 million, over $1 million from Grand County. There's over $1 million in funding from some landowners downstream. Other things that we're doing as far as mitigation, we actually provided some funding to the Fraser Valley Wastewater Treatment Plant, and that wastewater treatment plant is adding some facilities to remove phosphorus from the effluent of that plant, from the, what runs off of that plant back into the river, and that will reduce phosphorus pumped by Windy Gap up into the Three Lakes system. We are working on a contract with Fraser Valley Wastewater Treatment Plant to also do some additional work at the plant to remove nitrogens. We've spent about $4 million on the phosphorus removal. We expect to spend probably close to that on the nitrogen removal. So it's a big project that we're doing. And it not only improves water in the Three Lakes system, but it also improves the water in the Colorado River.